Jeremiah chapter 18, if you want to follow along in the reading of the Word of God, we're going to read through the first four verses in chapter 18. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, "Arise and go down to the potter's house. There I will cause thee to hear my words." Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels, and the vessels that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again, another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make it. Well, I want to preach on God is not finished yet. We oftentimes look at things when God is just really in the middle of doing his handiwork. We look at the world today and the world is in a mess. Our nation is in trouble. Many are looking to man to make things better, but can I tell you, we've dug us into a deep hole and we are in a mess. Our financial infrastructure is in a bubble, and many have been predicting for years that at some point, it's all going to just blow up and the bottom's going to fall out, if you will. And we've been hearing it for years. We've been looking at the circumstances throughout our nation with this election, how our nation is divided. I preached last week on Jesus Christ is the healer, and I'm going to believe his report. And if we look at the reports of the news media, if we look at the reports of the doom and gloomers, we are a nation that has turned our back on God. We are a nation that has forgotten God. And the scripture is clear that any nation that forgets God shall be turned into hell. So let's be honest, the forecast doesn't look too good for America. If we hear what the media is saying about Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton and all their lying and all their shenanigans, all their deception, I don't care what side you're on. I'll tell you this right now, neither one of them are going to make our nation any better than what it is. I believe that we need to understand we are in the hands of God. I want you to take notice today, brothers and sisters, that we are in trouble as a nation. But I want to encourage you with this word to let you know that no matter how bad it looks, no matter how bad our nation may go, how far we may turn from God with killing babies and allowing homosexuals to get married and allow all the different things that are transpiring in our nation that is turning its back on God. Yeah, the forecasts don't look too good, and many are being fearful and afraid, and Jesus said their hearts would fail them for fear. Let's be honest, it's a fearful thing to look at the condition of the world and the nations around the world. But can I tell you that God's not finished yet, brothers and sisters? We're looking at things that aren't going too well right now, and I want to bring it down to where our lives are. I want to apply it to where we live today, but you have to give me a few minutes to get to that place. I want you to read with me here in verse 3 and 4 where he says, "Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he seen the work of the potter on the wheel. And the vessels that he made of clay was marred." That word marred, if you want a definition, means simply it got messed up. It was disfigured. It was scarred. It was ruined. The beauty of it at one point when he was molding and making it, all of a sudden now, for one reason or another, and we'll get into that, the perfection of that, something went wrong. It was damaged. But I don't want to focus necessarily on the potter. I don't want to necessarily focus on altogether the marred. I want to focus on where the vessel was. It was in the hand of the potter. I think we overlook this oftentimes, that this vessel that was being made was in the hand of God. Can I tell you that's a good place to be? If you know Jesus Christ today as your Lord and your Savior, and you have been born again, and you have been washed by the blood, if you have been made a new creature in Christ where old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new, you are in the hands of God. And the Bible says no man can pluck you out of his hands. You can get up and walk out of his hand, out of his will and his purpose and his plan. But if you are in the hand of God today, you are in a safe place. This vessel was in the potter's hand. How many of us believe that our nation is a Christian nation? Our nation was rooted and grounded on Judeo-Christian principles, teachings. The Ten Commandments used to rule and reign in our courthouses and in our cities and towns all throughout the nation and around the world. But somehow we have thought that we, as this prosperous nation, how many of us know God has shed His grace on us? He has shed His blessings upon us. He has shed so many good things upon us because we as a nation look to Him as God, the God of all creation. And when they came over here on the Mayflower, the roots of our country started up here in New England, where there were men and women that feared the God of all creation. And the Bible says that when we fear God, that is a good thing. Because listen, brothers and sisters, it is the fear of God that will give you wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. But it is also a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Because if you're in His hands, He is really in control of your life. And I know that the forecast in our nation, and I can't even listen to the news anymore or read about it because it does start to discourage me. It starts to frustrate me when I look at the evil, I look at the corruption, I look at the sin. As the days of Noah were, so shall it be, the Bible says, in the days of the coming of the Son of Man, where the only thing that is upon the hearts of people is to do evil. Would you say we are living in the last days? How many believe that we are seeing the signs of the times? And brothers and sisters, evil men and seducers are waxing worse and worse, deceiving people and deceived themselves. And we are living in a nation that has false prophets all around us. We've got false prophets in this city that are proclaiming to people that, oh, we are still under the shadow of God's blessings. But can I tell you, it is only righteousness that exalts a nation, but it is sin that is approached to any people. Brothers and sisters, God's eyes are upon the righteous and His ears are open unto their cry. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. There is judgment coming to our nation. But can I tell you, despite what we're seeing in our nation, God is not finished with America. God is not finished with the church in America. God is not finished with you yet. He's working. He's working. And all you can see is an unfinished work. Jeremiah said, I looked at the potter and he was making that clay into what it needed to be. And in the midst of that, he says, and the vessel in verse 4, and the clay was marred. It was damaged. It was distorted in the hands of the potter. So he made it again. That ought to make you shout right there. I said He made it again. He made it again. He gave another chance, another opportunity. Where would some of us be today if God was a God that disregarded you after you first messed up, or maybe you sinned or fell or made a mistake? Aren't you glad that God's not a God that cuts you off like some people will? You got family members, you've got so-called friends and people. If you cheat them, if you lie to them or make a mistake and betray them, they'll cut you off. They'll hold a grudge. They won't want to even have anything to do with you. But aren't you glad that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever? He changes not. I'm glad today that Jesus Christ is the same and He does not change. People will change. People will turn their backs on you. People will despise and reject you. Thank God for Jesus. That He is a God of the second chance. He is the God of the third chance. He is the God that says, yeah, that's a broken life. They've shattered their life. They've backslid. They've turned their back on me. Look at their life. They made it a mess. But can I tell you, brothers and sisters, God's not done yet. Hallelujah. He's still working. I don't know where you are at today and what you're facing and what you're going through and what your family's going through, how you're dealing with problems in your life and in your marriage. I don't know what your financial situation is, but I want to bring it right down to where the rubber meets the road today and tell you that if you are a Christian, you are still in the potter's hand. He is still working in your life. Brothers and sisters, don't be dismayed. Don't be discouraged at what you see right now, for it only comes for a season, for there is a time and a season for everything under the sun. Give God a little time to work, and He will make it what it needs to be. This was in the potter's hand. It was marred, but he just didn't take that marred piece of clay and say, let's throw it out the window. Aren't you glad he didn't throw the clay away? Aren't you glad he didn't cut you off when you were rebellious, when you rejected him, when you weren't serving him the way you knew to serve him? Aren't you glad that he just didn't cut you off and reject you? But he's a God of mercy. He's a God of grace. He is a God of long suffering. I said he's a God of long suffering. He's willing that none should perish, but that all should come to repentance. What is the reason that the clay was marred? In other words, it was damaged. He was in the process of perfecting it, making it what it needed to be. It was in the hands of the potter. But something happened. It was damaged. One of the problems that I recognize with this clay as I studied on the potters and what they deal with as they're molding the clay up on the wheel. How many of us have seen a potter's wheel? The clay is, in this time period, it was dug out of the ground. It was mixed with water, and I can't get into all the details, but it was allowed to sit in like a basin for a while, which is a big tub, and it was covered up. And for a period of time, sometimes up to 6 months, they would cover it. And as it sat there, it got better and better. It got more moldable, got more pliable. It was easier to work with. So when the potter comes down to his house to make a vessel, he would take a scoop of that clay up. He would slap it onto the potter's wheel, and he would thrust his hand right down into the center of that vessel, and he'd begin to start working on it from the inside out. How many of us know that's where God begins to work on us as believers? I know there's a lot of churches that want to get you all cleaned up on the outside to make you present yourself as holy. Amen. But can I tell you, I've seen folks that clean it up on the outside, but they're still ugly and full of dead men's bones on the inside. But can I tell you, when you get it on the inside, it will reflect on the outside. When you really get God living on the inside of this sanctuary, this house, and this temple, He'll clean the inside. He'll wash you by His blood. He'll make you a new creature in Christ, where your desires will change, where your love for the things of the world and the things of sin will not be there anymore. Why? Because He is living on the inside of you, and He's molding you from the inside out. This is the work of the potter. He starts on the inside first. So what I'm saying today is, we all look nice today. We're in our church outfits. We got our perfume and our cologne on. We got our hair all fixed. And everything about every one of you, it looks nice on the outward. But what about what's going on the inside? The hidden things. It's easy to put a smile on when you come into a church and say, "Glory be to God, brother. How's it going? Everything's going good." And we all smile and we all say, "Everything's great." But brothers and sisters, we know better than that. I've been around this long enough to know. We've got folks right here. Amen. We're fighting some battles within. We're dealing with some troubles from within. We're dealing with some fear from within. Some of us are dealing in a state of confusion, not knowing which way to go or what to do. But can I tell you, even though your life may not look what you want it to look like right now, amen, you got it covered up with a nice suit and shirt and nice dress, but God knows what's going on the inside of your heart. It is man that looks on the outward, but it is God that looks on the inside of the heart. And really, what God really is interested in this morning, more than an outward display of a form of godliness, is He wants to reach down into our hearts this morning, and He wants to start to mold and make us into the people that He wants us to be. The clay that the potter was beginning to mold was marred. What was one of the things that could have damaged it? As I was reading and studying, one of the things that happens is the clay will get dry and stiff. I said, clay will get dry and stiff. How many of us know when you got a dry piece of clay, you can't really mold it. It cracks. It breaks. It crumbles. This is the problem. It's in the hand of the potter, but it's becoming stiff, hard, not pliable. Can I tell you that's one of the problems with many of us today? Why we're not bearing the image and the likeness of Christ? We're too rigid. Some of us have become too hard. Some of us have allowed ourselves to be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. We've allowed things to come into our life that sucks our spiritual moisture out of our life. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Some of us that are Christians are messing around with things in the world that we should not even be involved with. The Bible says, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather what? Reprove them. We've got a generation of Christians today that aren't bearing the image and the likeness of Christ with the fruits of the Spirit, because no fruit can grow because they're dry. I tell you, you've got to get into God's presence to get watered. I said, you got to consistently come into a place of worship where you can have your soul watered by the presence of the living God. It is the presence of God that comes down and smotes our hardened hearts that has been deceived by the deceitfulness of sin. Listen, Jesus said in these last days, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. I'm talking about that coldness that has entered into the hearts of people that makes them mean, makes them grouchy, makes them edgy, makes them hard-hearted, where they're snappy and mean to people. That should not be flowing out of our lives. Brothers and sisters, the problem with many of us is we have become stiff-necked and hard-hearted towards the things of God and even towards our brothers and sisters in Christ. Acts 7:51, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. Some folks can't be told anything without pride just rising up. I already know. He resisteth the proud. Why can't God use a proud vessel? Because he's only going to use those that he'll get all the glory. Amen. He said what? That no flesh shall glory in his presence. If he knows he can get the glory, he will use you for his glory. And we got to do all that we do for the glory of God. Can you say amen? What am I trying to say? Have we allowed ourselves to get hard towards the things of God? I mean, why can't some people worship God in a service where they feel the presence of God in it? It's because something has come into your life that you've allowed that has made you stiff and hard. And God can't mold you and make you. God sent me a good wife. How many of you know that a man that finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor of the Lord? Hallelujah. I like that. Some of you single brothers, what's wrong with some of you is you need a good wife to be a chisel to you. Smooth off some of those rough edges. Amen. My wife has helped smooth me out. How many brothers can just be honest and say amen? We need people in our lives that can smooth us out. I have always said God's got a sense of humor. God's got a sense of humor. He will bring people into your life at certain times and seasons in your life where he will use people to literally get on your nerves. I know we're holy. I know we're separated. I know we love God and don't love the world. And what I'm trying to say, brothers and sisters, is that sometimes we allow ourselves to get hard and not pliable. But can I tell you, God has been showing me that when we meet people at different stages in their growth in the Lord, we can't always judge them based upon what we see presently. Oftentimes, they could be in the hand of the potter. They're in the hand of the potter, and he's just not finished yet. Hallelujah. Can I tell you, he's just not finished yet. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, what we need to be willing to do is to come into the presence of God to say, Lord Jesus, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Do it on the inside, God. Make me a new woman. Make me a better wife. Make me a better mother. Make me a better friend. Make me a better husband. Make me a better father. How many want to not stay the same way they are, but they want to be made, amen, into the image and the likeness of Jesus Christ? That is the ultimate plan of God from the very beginning of creation, that He would have a people that would bear His image, bear His likeness. He said He took Adam and He took some clay out of the ground. He began to make him a man. How many of us know in the book of Genesis, He made him a man in His what? In His image and in His likeness. This has been the plan of God from the very beginning, is that He would have a people throughout every generation in this earth that would have a light that would be shining, that would bear the image and the likeness of the Son of the living God. And that's why we as a people in this city, we need to let our light shine before men, that they may see our good works and glorify our Father which is in heaven. Amen. Jesus is working on you, and He's wanting to make you what you need to be. But this morning, we want not to be hard-hearted. We need to be willing to be people that will submit to the potter's will. If He's wanting to smooth out some areas in your life, in your character, in your personality, how many of us know that's one of the hardest things to mold in somebody, is a new character. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. It takes Jesus to make a man of God. It takes the Holy Ghost to make a woman of God. It takes you being willing to submit yourself to the will of God and His plan and purpose for you. God had a plan for this vessel. He likens this vessel as to His people Israel. If you read on through chapter 18, let's read down here very quickly. The Bible says in verse 5, then the word of the Lord, this is Jeremiah 18 and 5, then the word of the Lord came to me saying, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter? He's saying, you, my people Israel, you, I'm showing you the example of what I want to do with you. He says, saith the Lord, behold, as the clay is in the what? Potter's hand, so are ye in mine, O house of Israel. At what instant shall I speak concerning a nation, concerning a kingdom, to pluck it up and to pull it down? God says, I've got the power, amen, because I am God. I don't answer to nobody. I can raise up a nation and I can also tear a nation down. He says, I can raise up kings and I can remove kings. Amen. How many of us know that He is Almighty God? He still is ruling in the affairs of men down here upon this earth. I know we look at our nation, we look at our people, you look at the condition of your life, of the financial situation, maybe your health ain't too good, maybe your marriage ain't too good, maybe you got children that are backslid and away from God, maybe you've got people that you know that you've got a burden for them, and you look at their present condition and say there's no hope for them. But can I tell you, I want to remind you that God's not finished yet. God is still working, God is still moving, and God has got a work to do in the lives of those that will submit themselves to the will of God for their lives. God's got a plan for every one of us. He's got a purpose. He wants to use you as an instrument here upon this earth to be able to bring healing, to be able to bring deliverance, to be able to bring hope to others that seem to have no hope. Do you have any family members that need healing? Do you got any loved ones that, amen, that God has placed upon your heart, and you look at their life and say, my God, look at the mess they've made of their life. Maybe it's your child. Maybe it's your son or daughter. Maybe it's a sister or brother. I don't know who it is. But I cannot tell you, if they're in the hands of the potter, they're in a good place. It might not look good right now. Presently, it looks like it's a mess. But give God a little time to work. He is not finished with the work. The potter is working in every one of our circumstances.